You know.
Does it need to be confirmed? What level of...
I don't know for that one.
That's a, that one does require confirmation, yes.
You know.
Like, there's a bunch of... What? There's a bunch of little ones that require confirmation, I guess, including her.
I love how all the Senate folks are taking the confirmation super seriously. Way serious.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure Linda McMahon's just gonna go through, but I'm glad that the.
Yeah.
Glad what?
I don't know if I'm glad.
Doing the job for the rest of it, like.
Yeah.
Attorney General is very important, as is Secretary of State.
Yeah.
Yep.
The hell they're having Linda McMahon do feels less important, but. Maybe I just don't know.
If anything, like, I was actually reading, because I was just so blown away by the whole thing that I actually read, like, what does this job that she got nominated for do? And it seems she's in charge of government contractors and small business loans. And I was like, I mean, that fits, you know, it's good enough.
She's one of the least egregious choices. Cabinet picks. It's...
Yes. She's like, she didn't get nominated and then immediately state that she was against all small business entirely. So it's like a huge step up.
Well, every other nomination. If you think of the way that WWE took over the territories,
if anything, she knows
may
contractors.
Or may not be against small business.
She knows contractors. Let's say that. Woo! All right. I don't know. It could be worse, probably. Right?
And it will be.
I mean, yeah, that's the thing, is like, I can't, like, I only have a limited amount of upsetness, and I'm going to need to save it, because I'm going to need a lot of it for the next 4 years. I'm going to need a lot of being upset.
Did you watch that clown show that was that press conference today?
No, I did not. That was kind of a failure. I didn't wake up till noon today.
It was bad.
Yeah, I'm glad I missed it. It sounds
it's a bad thing.
I like read a recap of it, and
like I was driving home, just like remembering pieces of it. I'm like, God, how is this a fucking thing?
I mean, when you have like still... other news networks coming out of the woodwork to say, no, CNN is not fake news. That's whatever. This whole thing is. Insane. The whole thing is insane, and I'm not 100% convinced that, like, I'm not imagining most of this.
That's did going you see on right now. The stack of like dossiers and papers and like manila folders filled with like paperwork that they supposedly did on like
it's all blank. Someone got a shot business. Of that, and it's like all
so,
blank.
That picture doesn't show.
I mean, maybe any, this... like. Maybe the second page
paper
on
paper has margins. Like, and none of that showed anything further than a margin.
Yeah.
So, but I would not put it past them to have that all be blank because no one could see them.
It just reminded me of that press conference when he was running for office where he had, like, all the water and, like, the champagne and, like, the Trump steaks behind him. Like, it made me think of, like, the same exact thing just again. Like, is it... Well, whatever.
It was funny because, like, he was introducing the lawyer that was going to explain all that stuff and, like, mentions this giant pile of papers. And, like, he's the one that introduces the pile of papers and then comes back later. He's like, oh, by the way, this is all the paperwork that we did. I don't know if that was explained well enough earlier. Like, he's blaming it on someone else, but he was the one that did it.
Great.
He's a real fucking...
That's like the story of Trump. He blamed someone else, but actually he was the one who did it. That's like every... It's every news story, basically. Is he blamed someone else, but actually it was him. The whole time. This will be good in the archive. Whatever.
We live?
Yeah.
Oh. Hey.
Hey, yeah. No, I'm just testing the audio to make sure everything
works.
Hey,
what?
Yeah.
Hey, so, hey, Trump.
I don't think he's here.
No, he's watching.
I wish. Well, I don't know if I. I don't know what
we're gonna hear about it at like 3 a.m.
Right, I'll be off watching AGDQ. So
good.
Wait on me.
Suplex Friends. Sad.
Sad.
Tell us something we don't know.
No awards for John Cena this year in the 2016 Suplex Friends. Sad. A disgrace to wrestling awards. Vince McMahon didn't win Owner of the Year. I wish we had a category for Owner of the Year now. Vince McMahon.
Dario Cueto.
Dario Cueto. Because he owns a temple.
Sure does.
Mm-hmm. Anthem. Oh, wait, no, I guess that's technically 2017 no, that's Owner 2017. Of the Year.
So that's the tough thing with this. We have to disqualify like Wrestle Kingdom 11
from this discussion. We just have to wait. Like that's next year's awards.
Yeah, yeah. I just want to make that clear.
Mm-hmm. Actually, I had to check on
get out best non WWE match right now though for 2017. If we want to just get a jump on that,
I didn't watch it, so I can't vote for it.
That's all right. You have 365 days to watch it. And then we'll, so get on it. You got time.
I signed up for NGPW World and everything. I might even give watching New Japan a shot.
Don't make the same mistake I did, by the way, the last time I canceled. If you eventually decide to cancel, they do not let you ride out the rest of the month. Like you're cut off immediately.
Sure.
I was going to at least watch through the New Beginning shows.
Yeah, that's my plan as well. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to watch through that, and then I don't know if I'm going to do more after that.
Y'all want to go to the G1 in whenever the month is that the G1 happens? Is that what it is?
It's in Long Beach, and so I'm definitely going to try to get tickets. I'm worried they're going to go like that.
They'll go quick.
Probably. Yeah.
I'm also worried that they're not going to bring... that they're not going to bring anyone cool over.
Well, yeah, I guess it depends. I guess we don't know what blocks of the G1
it's, are it's coming. It's two nights, out. Though.
Yeah. It's like... two nights, not tournament matches.
Oh.
Oh, it's... What?
No, so it's, then... it's a... They're, it's not actual G1 matches. It's like the G1 special.
That's dumb. Okay. I haven't watched the G1, so...
So it's probably, you know... It's probably gonna be good stuff, but like, do we get?
We don't get.
We probably only get one belt holder, for example. Like, I don't know if we're gonna get a heavyweight championship match.
Mm-hmm. We'll probably get the Young Bucks, unfortunately.
Not well, like, Bullet Club's not on the cards for the New Beginning shows.
Oh, really?
No, no Bullet Club on any of the New Beginning shows.
Weird. Not even like Cody the. Or...
Weird.
Yeah.
Even the Japanese people that are in it?
I thought it was... I'll double check, but I thought it was no...
So I have not even looked at those cards at all.
They were so severely defeated.
I mean, only Adam Cole won. And does he even count as Bullet Club? I don't even know.
Yeah, he's the U.S. leader. Hmm.
There's... and yeah, they're for the first time since their inception, there are no... No Bullet Club holds no belts,
except for the Ring of Honor title.
That doesn't count.
That doesn't count.
Ring of Honor doesn't matter anymore.
No. It's not a Japan belt.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't think any. Yeah, not, they're not on any of the New Beginning cards.
It sure is a New Beginning, then.
Andy does point out they did bring Naito, Okada, and Tana here for...
I mean, Naito has...
They did that show in... at Sam's Club, of all places, in Las Vegas that I almost, like, booked a trip to.
Oh, the Great Casino Sam's Club.
It was weird. I was like, of all places, I was like, Sam's Club? Like, I was like, but I actually thought about going because my grandparents live, like, three blocks from there.
They have to demonstrate the ring that they have that they're selling for $300.
It's so weird. But, like, Sam's Club has a really nice bowling alley. So then or Sam's Town. That's what it was. Sam's Town.
Oh.
Sam's
Club. Okay. Sam's Town. I'm like,
store? I keep getting. Yeah. No, it's a casino. But it's like,
okay, like it's like the Killers sing about it.
It's like a casino in the middle of the suburb, basically. It's like a real. It's weird. All right, so I think we're just gonna start without Phil, I guess. Okay. He said not to wait for him, so I'm not. Fuck Phil.
Harsh.
Yeah,
but
you
fair.
You're first. Where am I? All right, got my list. Are we just gonna do like we did last year? We just kind of roll through these and just kind of talk about it, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's some good matches on these new beginning cards, though.
Oh, really?
Naito versus Elgin. Yeah. Okada versus Suzuki.
Mike Elgin is like body goals. Like, for a fat dude, I was like, I could like just turn my like largeness into whatever that is pretty easily. I think by spending.
Goto versus Juice Robinson for the never open weight championship.
All right.
Think it's time for Juice. Peter
Parker gets his due.
He deserves it.
Not important. We'll
get
Total
Deep
ending, so I'll just start doing the New Japan minute.
Oh, is Total Divas over? So we can't have a total, or we can't have a Total Divas.
No, it's still going, and it's fantastic. But it's gonna wrap up soon, I think.
Okay. All right. Well, we'll get to that because we got a lot to catch up on. It's been quite a few weeks.
Well, they took a couple weeks off for the holidays, but yeah, there was an A plus episode of Total Divas since last we spoke.
Wow. All right. We'll save that to the end. I don't know if I can hold that long, but I'm pretty excited.
All right. I got my awards list up.
All right. Welcome to Suplex, friends. Don't interrupt me, John.
Shut your mouth, John.
Where stream friends talk pro wrestling. We're a very special episode today. My name is Dylan Hecht. I'm your host for the 2016 Suplexies, the most prestigious award for wrestling given out on a Wednesday at 9:30 at night.
Yeah, wearing the black tie of wrestling podcast garb, which is to say a American flag Brock Lesnar t-shirt.
Oh, my God. Art Tebble, bring in the fire. Bring in the class. What are you bringing, John? Carson.
I'm bringing our Lord and Savior. Oh. I can't get out of this chair.
Uh-oh.
It is
the greatest wrestling shirt. Perfect. Perfect. Now that's the face of an owner of the year, if I ever seen one. Phil Kohler, not here. He decided, actually, and made sure to tell me specifically that he doesn't love any friend of Suplexes. So he was never going to be here ever again.
I slammed him into a metal gate before the podcast started, so I don't think he's going to be coming out. Plus, don't tell him for a couple of weeks.
That's right.
Don't tell him. Art, you did it.
He received a violation. He received a violation of our wellness policy.
I did it for Rock.
So yeah, we got some cool wrestling stuff to talk about. This year, I'm trying to think, has there been any important, Wrestle Kingdom 11 happened. That was pretty important. That was cool.
Kenny Omega, like, kayfabed himself into free agency.
Except he's still signed for a year, right? That's why I read somewhere.
It depends who you believe. Like, apparently his old contract runs up on the 31st of this month.
Which is typical.
Everyone seems to agree that he's already signed a new contract, but he's just, like, taking some time off.
So he's going to come back as a guy who speaks Japanese and everyone's going to love him. Did you hear that pop in his promo when he spoke one line in Japanese? They loved it.
He could turn face, but I don't think they need him to. Maybe they do. Maybe that's what this break is about.
Mm-hmm. That'd be cool. He's a cool guy. And, well, based on awards that I'm giving out this year, I'm not convinced that WWE can use him in the right way compared to New Japan. That's for sure. So, stay far away, Kenny. Stay in Japan. It's fine. really, yeah, I promise.
He would need a contract that said, like, in writing that he'll get the AJ Styles push, right?
Yeah.
It'd just be like, I just want exactly the year AJ Styles just had.
Which, of course, Vince will then take to mean, well, that means he could lose to Chris Jericho pretty quickly then.
Oh, he's going to lose four times to James Ellsworth.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true. Perfect.
But legitimately.
Pinned. I'm trying to think what else was a big deal that happened. Total nonstop deletion happened.
This is true.
The episode of TNA filmed at the Hardy compound, which was surprisingly very good. It involved Matt Hardy's son making his pro wrestling debut, in which he defeated Rockstar Spud, which was good.
King Maxwell?
King Maxwell. That's right.
He needs a better wrestling name.
That's a pretty good wrestling name. King anything is like a good... I mean, look at that. King Barrett.
Boom.
King Mabel. King Sheamus. All those guys are superstars. Never been better. Well, Mabel probably been better, but... All right, let's just move on to the awards then. Whew. So I'm going to do these kind of out of order. I did not put them in a really good order, I guess. So I guess we'll start at the bottom of the good wrestlers with this year's best non-WWE match. Art Tebble, what do you have?
This was rough for me because I think I watched less non-WWE stuff in 2016, which might be the impetus for my New Japan World subscription more than anything. But I will give it to Grave Consequences 3.
Hmm. That was in the running for me, too.
And just like honorable mention, every other Mil Muertes match. Those are great. He's great.
He's awesome. He's the perfect giant dude.
What is Grave Consequences? I do not know.
Those are the casket matches they do in Lucha Under. Mm-hmm. And 3 was Prince Puma. So,
is that where someone actually dies?
Yeah, they've actually kayfabe died every time. Yep. I mean, it's been Mil Muertes is already dead, so it's...
Mm-hmm. Oh, he's the man of a thousand deaths.
He came back pretty quickly when it was him lost. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, the whole pomp and circumstance around all of those matches are amazing, and then they go over the top every single time. So yeah, excellent matches. I'm very excited for yours, John.
So
I know you also had the same problem I think that Art and I had.
Yeah, I was looking back, and I think there's actually only one non-WWE match that I watched this year. And it is the final deletion. And it was amazing. Mm-hmm. Everything that the Hardys are doing right now is completely ridiculous. That was ridiculous in the right way. Dylan and I were talking before the show about how it kind of brings back the whole backyard wrestling thing, but not in a stupid, dangerous way, and more of a fun, ridiculous, gonna hide behind this dilapidated boat while my brother's shooting Roman candles at me kind of way.
The weird jumping out of the tree was kind of dangerous. I'm not gonna lie there. That was
that's true, but
but Jeff Hardy.
Them. Yeah, exactly. Like, he swantoned onto steel stairs earlier this year.
Yeah.
Like, that's what that dude does.
Mm-hmm.
But I thought it was dumb and fun in the right way. And it was the best, I guess, with a qualifier that it is the only non-WWE match that I watched this year. But it was fantastic.
That's the thing. Is like, both your guys' matches were definitely runners-up for mine as well. Just the final delete. It was just... like, everything around it, from, like, the little intro movie beforehand, where they're, like, setting everything up, and then, like, dilapidated boats jumping out of trees, like, giant Hardy symbols getting lit on fire for some reason, like, old gimmicks rising out of the water. That was when, like, Willow showed up for no reason. Like, what? It was awesome. And, like, the perfect backyard wrestling, but done with, like, maybe like $55 more, you know, to buy the fireworks.
And a drone.
Yeah. But my best non-WWE match of the year, is Shinsuke Nakamura versus AJ Styles at Wrestle Kingdom 10.
Good one. I was thinking about that.
Yeah,
actually, I did watch that. Shit.
When it came down to my very final contending matches, for both WWE and non-WWE, I noticed one common thread was they all had AJ Styles or Shinsuke Nakamura in them. Mm-hmm. So I feel like this is perfect. And just like, again, another one, it's like amazing intros. Like, they're the intros, it's like Wrestle Kingdom is awesome because it's like, what if everyone got Triple H's intro? You know, like they actually put effort into everyone instead of just one dude, you know? And then like the match itself was just like nail biting every single moment. I mean, even though I guess at that point we all kind of knew that he was leaving, right? Or was it
both of them?
Yeah.
No, it didn't really come out until after, right?
I can't remember.
Late honestly. December, I want to say.
I can't remember, like...
I thought it was, like, January 5th. I thought it was, like, they had that match happen, and the next day it was, like, they're all gone.
Maybe that was it. But either way, like, I just remember watching that. I did not watch that live. I watched it the next day, because I can't stay up that late all the time. But it just was, like, nail-biting every single moment, and then just had, like, even, like, comedy bits where, like, you know, AJ does the Bullet Club shooting the bullet at Nakamura, who then catches it and eats it. Like, just every single kind of, like, storytelling device you could use in a match, from, like, tension to humor to, like ridiculous violence, was all in there. And it was a perfect match for me. Definitely.
Super, super good. It looks like, yeah, it was January 5th, I believe. So, yep, day after.
And I'm super glad that both of those guys...
used to end.
Yeah. I'm super glad that both those guys are now at WWE just so that I can see them wrestle more, I guess. So yep. I'm super happy about that. let's see. Let's move on to... let's just do best non-WWE wrestler. John, you look nervous. I'm going with you first.
Yeah, once again, I've not seen much outside WWE. This is purely on a microphone, on a promo level, but I'm going to say Eli Drake.
Yes! Oh my goodness, yes! Dummy, yeah.
Yeah, so, like, I've seen a couple of his talk shows, and they've been pretty damn great. Mm-hmm. Very fluid on the mic, reacts well with everything. I haven't seen him wrestle though, but that's half the battle is being a good personality.
He's got the
and
look
I think
too.
He's got it. Yeah. Yep. But that's it. I mean, otherwise, I would say like Kenny Omega.
Yeah, I'm definitely on the fence as far as buying an Eli Drake T-shirt from Pro Wrestling Tees. I'm not gonna like the one that just has his head right here and just says "Dummy, yeah." Like in the little, I know I've been thinking about it, but I
just do it.
Yeah, maybe I'll just do it and just buy the shirts I want, and then so I can combine shipping. We'll see. Art, how about you?
I want to just disclaim here that when I was figuring this out, I like forgot that TNA existed.
You're not the only one. Don't worry.
It happens.
But like when we were talking about match just now, I was like, oh yeah, Matt Hardy should probably have been in at least the conversation for mm-hmm. best non-WWE wrestler. I think it's still Naito.
Okay. Mm.
I think he had a hell of a year. I think he's really like kind of coming to his own as a character. But yeah, Matt Hardy should have been in that running for me, and he just wasn't.
Yeah, Naito, like, definitely, and especially, like, this year, like, at Wrestle Kingdom, kind of capped it off, as he kind of went from, like, face no one cared about to, like, gone, and then heel everyone loved, and then now, like, heel everyone was booing against Tanahashi. Like, it was a perfect, granted, the last part of it happened in 2017, but it's still, like, the perfect, like, storyline arc for him. But I don't think you have to worry about Matt Hardy, because my best non-WWE wrestler of the year is Broken Matt Hardy.
Not regular Matt Hardy?
That's right. Not regular Matt Hardy. Broken Matt Hardy only. Because that, like, legitimately, like, made Matt Hardy relevant again in an entirely new, insane way. Like, just, who, like, from the moment, like, I saw it and I was like, this is the stupidest thing I think I've seen in a long time.
It's like, really dumb.
And then, like, probably within, I don't know, like, 10 minutes, I was like, actually, this is the greatest thing I've ever seen. And then just evolved from there to, like, showing him in his house that he's got, like, some sort of, like, dude that just, like, writes delete in a book over and over again. And then took another hit on the head and became regular non-wrestling Matt Hardy for some reason, and then, like, became broken Matt Hardy again, and he can play the piano poorly, which I didn't realize also. I would say his wrestling kind of, it's funny, like, this is, like, almost like yours, John, that it's, like, 90%, like, mic work for me.
Yeah, yeah.
But
it's all storytelling.
It's because the wrestling is, like, it's just Matt Hardy still, but like, the broken Matt Hardy character, like, definitely makes me care about Matt Hardy and enjoy seeing him in the year 2016, which I didn't actually think was possible. So, no, I'm super happy that Matt Hardy is back in the weirdest way ever.
All I can imagine now is Matt Hardy on the riding lawnmower, just mowing his brother's shitty designs.
Yes. So let's see. Let's go through some of these. Let's go to a bad award.
Okay.
I think we'll go with worst storyline of the year. And this was actually, it took me basically up until about 10 minutes before I started to finally confirm between two. So I guess I'll go the one I actually went with was Triple H showing up and basically giving the title to Kevin Owens and then completely disappearing and only being referenced barely. And now, honestly, this storyline doesn't even matter except for maybe once a month Rollins gets mad at Triple H on a mic. Like, it went, I granted, it's going to go somewhere, I'm sure. But in the in 2016, okay, I didn't say it was going to go anywhere good, Art. I saw that face. But it's going to go somewhere. Maybe not somewhere good. It might win 2017's worst storyline of the year also. But it's just like in the box of 2016, what the fuck, basically. Nothing. But the runner-up, I don't want to steal anyone's thunder, but the runner-up that I almost picked, I think you know what it is, John.
Do I?
I don't know, maybe. Do I? Roman Reigns.
And Rusev?
Yes. Because Roman Reigns is a giant asshole in that entire thing. What a terrible... Yes. Like, once again, I remember last year, the worst storyline of Suplexies 2015 was Ziggler and Lana, wasn't it? Or no?
That was certainly mine.
Yeah, I think that was mine also. So, once again, I feel like stop using Lana as a prop for other guys to be into or mess with. I don't know. It just doesn't work.
Let me tell you about using Lana as a prop for guys to be into. Oh. My worst storyline, it's the only one I can think of, is Enzo Amore. God. And Lana.
Yeah.
And the whole getting trapped outside the locker room naked and then hitting on Lana, who is notoriously married.
Yes.
Like, everyone knows this. And he hits on her. Rusev gets mad. She invites him to a hotel room and tells him to take off his clothes. And then Rusev comes and beats the crap out of him. And it's just...
And don't forget the part after that where they teased a Lana and Rusev sex tape for no reason also.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That's right. That's right.
How bad? Like,
yeah, it was the thing that really put Enzo on, like, a downslope for me.
And I remember
they started to kind of put, like, a a morality to him, like more so than like, this is my friend, he's gonna beat you up. If you beat him up, I'm gonna beat you up. Like that kind of just.
We're... This is my friend who's gonna beat you up while I steal
right,
your wife.
He's 7 foot tall. You're certified G's. You can't teach that. Oof. Once you go further than that.
But you can teach manners, Enzo.
No, he had manners. He was gonna go. It's not the right thing. But then he stayed because he's.
He took his clothes off anyway.
Yeah.
And I remember last year we speculated that the Lana Dolph Ziggler thing was maybe Lana's being punished for the weird engagement thing. But now I think it's they just don't know what the fuck to do with Lana, really. That's the real answer. And it shows, unfortunately.
Yeah, mine was everything that Lana did this year. Those two plot lines and... I think we're forgetting this because it was a long time ago. That, like, going into WrestleMania storyline where it was like, she's her, like, Daniel Bryan plotline. Like, they don't know what they're doing with her. And I don't know. They just need to stop. Like, why can't she go back to being the badass manager she was 2 years ago? Like,
I thought she was going to, like, NXT now. Like, there was that whole thing.
Matches, yeah.
Yeah, they just need to chill for a minute. Just if you can't give her a good storyline, it's okay that she's just an awesome manager. That's fine. Yeah. Whatever. Come on, WWE, get the fuck together. All right.
Like, I really like the combination of Lana and Rusev.
Yes.
Like, it's great. When it works, it is awesome. Yeah,
but when the storyline is someone wants to have sex with Lana, that's not Rusev. It's really bad.
Baby faces trying to ruin the marriage of these two happily married people.
Yeah, I don't.
Who are supposed to be heels?
Doesn't make any sense at
it makes
all.
Zero sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Especially if their wedding's going to be a Total Divas plotline. I know we're not in the Total Divas minute yet, but
that's true. It was a Total Divas plotline, right? Like.
Yeah. Still is. It's ongoing.
And really, how can you hate Rusev after you see pictures of him after he straightened his hair this weekend?
He looks good, by the way, with the straight hair. Magical. Mm-hmm. That mane of his is glorious. That's good. Some broken Matt Hardy tier hair.
That was a rough segment that he had on Monday, though.
I didn't watch Raw. I don't even barely watch the YouTubes of Raw anymore. But I do watch SmackDown all the time. Still good, by the way. Best brand of the year.
Whoa.
That's not
award. That's not a category.
That's an unofficial award. Unofficial honorable mention for best brand of the year goes to SmackDown.
I mean, not the Titus brand?
He won the most underutilized talent award from me last year, Titus O'Neil. What the fuck happened? Oh man, I was like talking him up so much last year. I remember this.
Mm-hmm.
You were wrong. They used him more, and it was terrible.
Yeah, used him. It was completely
guess
fucked.
What? They are still using him with NXT skits.
Wait, really?
From 6 years ago.
Oh,
you should watch Raw.
See, but everything you tell me actually means I shouldn't watch Raw.
You're watching Raw, so you don't know the horrible new Titus plot line.
So what here's, is it? Here's how it goes. Titus is trying to be a member of the New Day.
Okay.
He's trying to be goofy. He's trying to dance. But then he ends up insulting one of them. Like, last week he insulted Xavier Woods, and then Xavier's like, yo, let's go. They have a match. Xavier wins. Mm-hmm. This week, Titus is chill again. And New Day brings up this time on NXT where he was supposed to carry a keg around the ring and, like, bring it to a finish line. And immediately Titus had fallen and, like, just totally biffed it.
So weird 2010.
So they gave him another chance at it. So he had to race around the ring holding a keg, which he dropped before the finish line, which made him mad at Kofi. And then he fought Kofi. And Kofi won.
You forgot the headline of the second segment, which was that keg was full of Booty juice.
Oh, booty juice.
Booty juice. It makes sure your throat is loose. I can't believe they could say that on television. On
yeah. What?
I totally forgot about that.
They said that on... Yeah. Holy sh... Speaking of which, have you heard this rumor about the Noam Dar plotline?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That... Okay, so for those that haven't, it's that Vince is really into having Noam Dar and Alicia Fox do storylines together, because when Noam Dar says her last name, it sounds like Fox, and the censors can't actually do anything about it. And that sounds like the most fucking Vince thing ever. Like, true or not, it's 110% believable.
True or not, and I absolutely believe it's true.
Yes. That's the only reason to explain that garbage storyline, really. Alicia Fox. Yeah, I believe it. 100%. All right, so let's... I'm going to skip around a little bit more.
Okay.
To NXT Star of the Year. Art Tebble, who is your NXT Star of the Year?
The Revival?
Yes.
Yes, that is the correct answer.
That is the correct answer. I think we all picked the Revival, which is... This is why I was like, do we need a tag team category? Yeah. And then I was like, because I was going to say I picked the Revival, but I didn't want to spoil it. And then John said that he also picked a tag team, and I was like, well, let's see here. So yes, the Revival are the NXT Stars of the Year, 100%.
Yeah. And, like, big ups to Asuka, Samoa Joe, everyone, really. But the Revival have
Ty
been...
Dillinger. Ty Dillinger was on the short list for me.
Yeah.
Because he's been doing work. It's funny, like, sort of considered Samoa Joe and Asuka, but not really. Like, I felt like that was cheating in a way.
And, like, Shinsuke just seems to be doing Shinsuke things, and that's cool.
He's doing
it's
his business.
Like...
But the Revival bringing back old school wrestling... They have...
Just putting on awesome matches.
Yeah.
Every takeover.
They've been killing.
The match with DIY was...
Great.
Masterclass.
They got the look. They have the good catchphrase. No flips, just fists. That's perfect.
Top guys.
They're great.
No, and it's like, if you told me at the end of NXT TakeOver Dallas that I would see the Revival have two better matches that year, I wouldn't have believed you. Like... They're insane. I also found another place to give Samoa Joe an award, so it's all going to work out.
Not bad. But yeah, 100% Revival, absolutely killing it this year. I'd love to see them either on SmackDown or Raw, but I'd prefer SmackDown.
SmackDown.
But I think them, them coming into SmackDown and continuing a thing with, or picking back up a thing with American Alpha could be good. I mean, I don't know what this weird Wyatt thing going on is right now, but...
It's very odd.
Very strange, but it's... But, like, I can't be too mad at it because I'm a fan of the Wyatt, like, new theme song with the Randy Orton song mixed in, you know? It's all right.
Yeah, and, like, the weird distortion that they put on the Orton stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It's good.
It's good. But the Revival are better. Boom.
It's true. It's true. Talk, guys.
That's right. Let's see. So going from NXT Star of the Year, we'll move on to WWE Rookie of the Year, which I think we qualified last time as anyone who's made their in-ring WWE debut main roster in 2016. And something tells me John isn't ready, so I'll go with my pick, which is Alexa Bliss. Came to the main roster and killed it immediately. Like, instantly awesome. And then this whole SmackDown thing, the Harley Quinn look was, like, odd at first, but then kind of grew on me. Her thing with... What's that?
She needed it. She needed a thing.
She needed a thing, and this was perfect.
Dangerously close just being too generic, and it's not, like, original, but it works.
It works great. Mm-hmm. And then her, like... Cutting promos on Daniel Bryan constantly on Talking Smack was awesome. I think my favorite was when Daniel Bryan compared her to him, and she just had the most disgusted look on her face. Like, I'm nothing like you. And that was perfect. And then this thing with Becky Lynch is great.
In the biz.
And then, oh, she, her faces are, yeah, easily some of the best. And then now, dressing up in weird costumes, it's just, yeah, she's great as a wrestler. She's a great champion. She's got a great look. She even has good wrestler merchandise that I'm not 100% sure why that hasn't been, like, cease and desisted by Warner Brothers yet. But I'm happy it exists.
They don't own hair.
That's true. They don't own hair. They do not. John, who's your pick?
So I don't think I gave him the due that I should have last year. And he was not in a WWE ring for long. But I'm going to give it to Finn Balor he's always solid in the ring, and yeah, he only had three matches on the main roster this year. His match with Seth Rollins was great. Also, he dislocated his shoulder during that match and popped it back in and finished that match. I think that deserves a lot of respect for him. And I'm looking forward to when he comes back, maybe in 2 weeks. And 3 weeks?
Three weeks.
Man, it feels like it should be sooner. But he was someone that, when they did the brand split, that made me super excited when he actually got on Raw and made a splash.
That pop when they said his name for the draft was insane. Mm-hmm. That was great.
Yep. So, yeah, I think he did good things this year. Mm-hmm. Even though it was a short year for him. It's a very, very short year.
So he's going to have the good comeback soon, I feel it.
Mm-hmm. Also, he's the first Universal Champion.
That's true.
The first. That's pretty impressive. The second longest reigning Universal Champion.
I guess you're right. I didn't think about it like that. In fact, I guess it's both NXT people are truly the Triple H of belts. Who did you pick, Art?
AJ Styles.
Whoa, see, I thought about that and I was like,
I almost went for that.
That's fair. That's a good call, I would say. Have an amazing... Yeah, I mean, I don't think there's been anyone that's had a run like him in WWE in, like, such a short amount of time.
Since Brock Lesnar.
Yeah, and it's not fair. Because he's not a rookie by any reasonable sense of the word. But,
no,
but fits his qualification, and so I picked him.
It's allowed in the rules.
It was definitely, I considered it very heavily. Definitely, but he's had quite the run, and just like you see guys come in from outside a lot and don't like they take time to build up something while they just kind of hang around for a while. And I mean, I don't know if it's because of his age or what, but WWE's definitely like they fast tracked him into the hot seat, and it was a good choice. Better choice than having him lose to Jericho at WrestleMania.
Yes.
Wild.
Honorable mention in this category to Chad Gable.
Oh, just be
awesome.
Yeah. American Alpha was on the short list, too, because they've done good things. Like I said, the wide thing notwithstanding, it's just a weird storyline. But, I mean, come out the gate just, like, with great matches, and then just botting the Usos in, like, 3 minutes in that match was pretty cool. All right, let's see. Let's go with... We've had a little too positive, so I'm going to go with another bad award. The second and final, because I don't like doing these bad awards, but I think it's important to recognize some stuff.
Oh, yeah. Things go wrong, and we need to call them out on it.
Yeah. So, the Big Show Please Retire Award for Superstar That Needs to Take a Break. I'm going to give this one... to the Demon Kane. It's time to chill, bro. Like, listen. I like Kane. I'm not gonna hate on Kane, but He mainly exists kind of to, like, take the L a lot, and I understand there has to be a guy there to do that.
Yeah.
But then they also try and use him as, like, the scary, threatening guy, too. And it's like, at this point, I feel like, maybe it's just me, but, like, the existence of Kane as scary, supernatural guy, like, inherently fucks with the Wyatts. Because, yeah. Like, they should, like, the Wyatts should be in the Undertaker Kane role of, like, creepy guys who kind of show up out of nowhere and can, like, be super dangerous at any time. But instead, they still, like, insist on giving that role to Kane. And it just doesn't play anymore. At least not for me, I guess. So maybe it's time to, like, just... Maybe even Kane could, like, slip into an Undertaker-style role where he just shows up, like, once in a super great once-in-a-while thing, you know?
He hasn't been on SmackDown that much recently, though. No, like, since
he was on a couple...
Randy joined the Wyatts, like...
He was on a couple weeks ago, and I don't remember why, but Daniel Bryan specifically called him out as my friend Kane when he introduced him for a match. I don't remember who it was against either now. Maybe Baron Corbin?
Sounds like a huggable...
I think it was toy. Baron Corbin, like, as a punishment, had to fight my good friend Kane. And I was like, this is not, like...
Is that a different character from Corporate Kane or the Demon Kane?
Good Friend Kane?
Good Friend Kane.
Good Friend Kane.
Good Buddy Kane.
And I guess, yes, in storyline, they are... I don't know if they are good friends in storyline. Like, they were kind of barely tolerate each other in the first place. But whatever. Either way, just... Kane doesn't have to go away forever. But he should just... Like, show up for, the big events. Like, if he didn't show up until the 2018 Rumble, that'd be all right. Yeah. You know? You could high-five to Undertaker. Brothers of Destruction, one final run. Double coffin match. Where they both go into the coffins. The end.
An Iron Maiden match.
And then they can go away forever. All right. Art, what's your pick?
See, this is how I know you don't watch Raw, because there's a very obvious answer to this one, and it's Titus O'Neil.
Last year's Cesaro Award winner, Titus O'Neil, now wins the Big Show Award. At least he didn't say
Big Show. I just need a break from him, and maybe it's a forever break. Maybe he just doesn't find his way back. But, you know, maybe he does. But right now, it needs to be the other way.
Yeah. It doesn't sound like he's had a good year. Like, Titus Brand was not a good gimmick. Like, this New Day thing sounds terrible. And then the whole, like, built-up thing about being a great father and then having him lose in front of his children. Like, fucking, come on, man. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, I could definitely see that. Just chill, Titus. Chill on Titus. That could be his next character. Chill Titus. Just kind of like goes like this all the time. Tranquillo. That's it. That's what they just need to do. Now he can just be the Naito of WWE. No. What's your pick, John?
So, man, I didn't want to do this.
Uh-oh.
I didn't want to do this.
Oh, no.
It's Mick Foley.
Whoa!
I did not want to do that.
Wow.
He's struggling.
Yeah? Is he not good in the general manager role, really? Because he's done it once before and he was okay, or he's commissioner role.
Yeah, the only times I kind of dig him in that role is when he gets, like, super fired up about someone, like, about to lose their life by going into a match, and that's it.
I was about to say, because I watched not that long ago, and I feel like the Sami Zayn Braun Strowman thing was actually kind of a highlight.
Right.
But then, like, the Sasha Charlotte thing was a low light. So.
Him and Stephanie, like, that chemistry's not there. Nope. Not at all. Yeah. And he's constantly fumbling his lines. He's just, go rest.
Or stick to the other show. He's on another show, you know? Is he good on that? I watched, like, the first two episodes.
But Holy Foley?
Yeah.
I don't believe so. I heard it was bad.
If even Art's not watching it, then I know it's bad reality TV.
Yeah. But yeah, that man needs to heal. Go rest for a while.
Well, I guess you're going to get your wish soon. He's going to take quite a long break, I imagine. Because hip surgery is no joke. I have had it myself, and that's an easy 8 months out. And I'm not that old, so at his age...
They keep threatening him off and then didn't do it. That's the weird thing.
Well, so a couple weeks ago when they started introducing the shark cage thing, and like that was right after all the news broke that like, yeah, he's going to have hip surgery. Like he's in excruciating pain. Like he wasn't supposed to be at this pay-per-view, but he came out just for effect for the whole Braun Strowman and Sami Zayn storyline. And the next night he is jumping in the ring towards the shark tank or the shark cage.
Like yeah.
That.
That's a guy who will give it all for the company, unfortunately.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Love you, Mick. Just, I'm sorry.
Out of curiosity, have they said, is there going to be like a replacement GM while he's gone? Because like I said, like hip surgery is a long time out. That's like I said, like half a year or so. Or I guess maybe it'll just be a surprise.
Bring back Stone Cold.
Well, they haven't like officially written him off yet, so.
No.
Okay. Shawn Michaels.
He was on Raw.
Mr. Ass, Billy Gunn. I guess he's suspended.
He's not with the company.
Yeah, he's suspended. Yeah, never mind.
Hulk Hogan. Kurt Angle. All right. What's the next category?
Yeah, let's go with something good.
Another pressed.
So let's go with the opposite award of the Please Retire Award. The Cesaro Award for Most Underutilized Talent. Art, who is the most underutilized talent in WWE right now?
Heel Sasha Banks.
Okay. I 100% agree on that.
Yes,
wow.
Yes.
It's not the right answer. Like I'm cheating, but
it's a different than expected answer, but I like it. Shouldn't work like this face thing is not working out.
Yeah, really. She's a B minus face and an A plus heel, and she just can't do it because of Charlotte.
Yeah. And the tough part is I don't even know how you bring like her in. I guess we have to get the belt off of Charlotte first, I guess. Get it away from Charlotte first, but yeah.
Or Charlotte, but that's gonna take some doing at this point.
Yeah, face Charlotte's gonna be a little difficult at this point. But yeah, no, that's one I hadn't even. That's like it's an angle I hadn't even thought to go at this. But yeah, you're 100% right, John. Who is the most underutilized talent in WWE?
Yo, I haven't seen Paige in months. Where's she been?
Oh boy!
Kidding, kidding.
Yeah.
Yo, all right. This one's a little bit out of left field. I don't know if you guys are gonna agree with me. I think they could do more with Breezango.
The fashion
I think
police,
good
you
hands.
Mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And there's something weird that's kind of like the. The SmackDown tag division is kind of floundering a little bit right now. Like American Alpha is really good. Like one of the Usos is out injured. I don't know where
Mojo is out or not Mojo. Or,
yeah, the Zack Ryder's out. I don't know where Aiden English and Simon Gotch have been.
Yeah, the Vaudevillains have disappeared entirely.
Vaudevillains are gone. The Ascension was on like. A couple of weeks ago, but it's really right now. It's American Alpha and it's the Wyatts and Heath Slater and Rhino, kind of, but
not even really that.
Right. So, yeah, I think that in this coming year, they could do something good with Tyler Breeze and Fandango.
I don't even think the Fashion Police is a bad gimmick for them. It's
no,
just
it's,
not.
It's really just like a slight pivot on what they are already.
Yeah. Like it could be, I mean, it might be a little on the nose. Like they don't actually need police uniforms and to make a siren noise every time they show up.
I liked it for that pay-per-view that they started doing it at.
And I liked it when they gave a fashion ticket to King Booker. That was also very good. But see, like, that show, like, there's potential there. It's just not, they're just not being used well.
And I know people think that, I've heard people say, like, Tyler Breeze was overrated in NXT, but I think he's a very, very good worker. So is Fandango.
Mm-hmm.
Both I think guys. They probably could have put on some really good matches with American Alpha if they
let them
take, if they take them serious.
That could be a great heel. Like, there's not fashion stuff to critique on Chad Gable, for crying out loud. Come on. Well, my choice.
So American Alpha's gear is terrible.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's like an easy match right there.
Yeah.
Maybe one day.
Dylan, who's yours?
Sorry, I just saw this comment from Noel 808. The VOD villains fusion danced into Jack Gallagher. It's true. He just does everything they tried to do with them, but way better. But my answer for most underutilized talent in WWE is Gallows and Anderson, the club.
Mm-hmm.
I think those guys have been used extremely poorly. Like, started out great. Like, came out of nowhere. Attack fools, taking people out.
Yep.
You know, too sweet with AJ Styles. Like, great. And then they had the whole, like, started to go a little weird when, like, AJ Styles was face, but then kind of got a little bit better. But then it's like, since the brand split, it's like the old day? The thing where they had, like, the New Day's balls in a jar?
Right.
Like, yeah. Those guys can do comedy, but you have to give them something comedic to do. Like, the old day was like, if we had an award for the worst segment in all of wrestling, it was the old day segment.
No, that was. Don't we have a? We already did worst storyline.
We have worst storyline, but that's not really a storyline.
That would have. That was kind of a storyline.
I guess, but just bad. Just bad. Like, these guys, they can do comedy. They can do serious. They can wrestle really well. And they're not doing any of those things. They even have their theme song is really not even like.
It's not great.
It's not great. Like, a lot of better things could be done with these guys. And it's just not. And it really bums me out. Like, maybe they just need to put them back with AJ in some way. Maybe that's what it takes, is, like, use the star power of AJ to rub off on those guys, and they can take off from there.
Or Finn.
Or Finn. Or Finn Balor, true. You know.
Well, so now they're currently feuding with Sheamus and Cesaro. And they had Anderson on commentary this week. He's actually pretty good.
Yeah, he can talk.
Pretty entertaining, so.
He's a leader of the dang Bullet Club, for crying out loud. The machine gun. Well, for like 2 minutes, but.
I mean, AJ was never the leader. According to him. Well, according to him.
They're still too
sweet. According to the world.
Yeah. It's fine, but just do something with those guys. Like, come on.
Also, I was surprised that they kept Anderson's finisher, kind of.
Kind of.
So, he's not doing an RKO, he's doing a flying neck breaker.
Yeah. That's, I mean...
As he called it. Yeah, I like that he kept it in some way.
It's in
like,
some
way. We'll just flip the dude instead.
Mm-hmm. And, like, their tag team finisher is awesome. Like, Magic Killer's a great finisher.
They have two finishers.
What's the other one?
The big boot?
Oh, that's right.
The boot of doom,
Boot of doom.
See, they have good moves. It's just now turn them into cool guys. Let's see. We'll go through. I just realized that's kind of like a negative award also. But not.
No, it's something that we have hope for.
Yes, I believe. Though we'll see. Maybe I will hit the curse again, and then those guys go like really down to the dumps. Oof, let's hope not. Most improved this year, John Carson.
That would be. Oh man,
this is one I feel like there's a high potential for us all to agree on.
It's the Miz.
It is the Miz.
The Miz is the most improved character wise. He found a fire that he hasn't had in years. And I'll go into that more later.
I'll go into it right now. He's proved that he is one of the best heels in the company right now. In promo, in wrestling style, like, he's just in look. Like, just seeing him, like, just when they have the, like, the LED ramp and it turns red, like a giant red carpet as he walks down it. And, yeah, just, like, introduce himself as the greatest Intercontinental Champion, and my wife is the most beautiful person in the world, and, like, I'm the best at everything, and Daniel Bryan is an idiot and doesn't love the fans, unlike me.
And taking Daniel Bryan's moves and just, like, doesn't really have a storyline going with him currently, but still just does it because it pisses people off.
He's just so good. Super good. At being hateable, and he's really shown it again this year in a way he hasn't since he was using the real world gimmick, you know?
Yeah.
And teamed with Alex Riley.
The Miz has always been great, I think.
is what you mean.
We're definitely in a Miz renaissance. I think Maryse, for whatever reason, has really helped. I don't know if it's what she's doing or if he's just like, he gives more of a shit because he gets to hang out with his wife more.
Maybe.
But, like,
maybe it's a partner thing because he was doing great with Alex Riley.
You know, we're not that far from another big Miz time. I think, I think Chris Jericho is someone who should have been considered is not who I picked. But, like, a year ago, I was ready for Chris Jericho to go away forever, and now he got clipboard over.
Yeah.
But Charlotte Flair is my most improved.
Oh. Okay. All right.
She went from, like, not being able to cut a convincing promo at all to being a pretty good promo. She still needs to not shout. She's bad at phrasing when she's shouting.
Mm-hmm.
But she's really turned it on this year.
Yeah. And I like that they... She has done... The best thing that ever happened to her was getting rid of Ric Flair, also.
Absolutely.
Like, it's made her better as a promo, and not having to rely on Ric Flair in matches has made, like, her matches... all of her wins much more convincing. I mean, obviously.
But... Her matches seem smoother since then.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Because when you have someone as legendary, who's also her father... Mind you, like, watching every match that you're in,
it's tough.
Like, that's pressure.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Let's see. So let's do
honorable mention to Baron Corbin on that one.
Absolutely. I think Baron Corbin. The only reason I didn't consider him as a full winner is mainly just because he has improved, but he still has. A lot of room to improve from here, you know. But even like his match yesterday with John Cena was great, you know. Mm-hmm. Which also, I don't know about. This is the first year I didn't give any awards to John Cena. Granted, we've only done this once before, but in my head, I have given awards before this, and John Cena didn't win none, and that bums me out this year. That's why I didn't wear my John Cena hat because I don't deserve it as a true Cena fan. Let's move on to
Corbin is that he like split his improvement over 2 years.
Yeah.
That, like if we gave these awards out in like July, I think it would have been Corbin because like that year was his most improved year. Whereas this is like the second part of Corbin's monumental growth.
Yeah. But I feel like he does have potential totally to like do the full, like really break out as a heel. This year,
Rolling Stone put out an article, I think today, calling him the next big guy in the WWE. They're saying he's Roman Reigns.
I mean,
let's
before his main roster debut, he was easily my most hated in NXT, which is really saying something because Austin Aries is there. But
wait, most hated just like heelish wise, or you just don't like?
I didn't think what he was. Does. I didn't think he deserved the attention he was getting. He was not really putting in work on his physique. He was not really putting in work on the mic. He was not putting in work in the ring. All he had was that he was really tall. And I was like, that's not enough.
He finished his matches real quick.
Yeah. And I was like, that's not. But he's
definitely. Don't forget, he is the most metal athlete of 2016.
Well, yeah, that's true. We did, unfortunately, we could not. I should have made that award just to give to him. But maybe next year you could win Most Improved.
I mean, it would be gold dust, right? Because that's actually a medal.
It's true.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
Absolutely. Gold dust.
Gold dust, most medal wrestler of the year 2016. Suplexy, unofficial. best storyline. Now, I purposely did not specify WWE, although my choice is WWE. Best storyline for me is the friendship of Kevin Owens and Chris Jericho. That it has evolved in a way from Kevin Owens feeling bad for Chris Jericho and deciding to help him out to this suddenly giving like Chris Jericho a ton of ego and the list of Jericho and their best buds and they're hanging out all the time to like maybe Kevin Owens was having some problems and Chris Jericho was there to help out his boy. And then I feel like the next the next stage of that has to be coming soon. But easily this was a good storyline with good guys that really sold it really well. Backstage, in the ring, all of that. Just like co-like holders of the WWE Universal Championship. Like, just great. Just great. I loved it. John?
So I kind of said I'd go back to this. Best storyline this year is The Miz and Daniel Bryan. So talking smack is one of the best things to happen to WWE television in a long while, especially with Daniel Bryan not giving a fuck. And just like talking about whatever he wants to talk
just
about.
100% shoot on talking smack.
And that's what started this whole thing with The Miz. Whether that was a shoot or a work, doesn't matter. But
irrelevant.
The Miz got so fired up after Daniel Bryan said that he worked too safe, that he's afraid to fight, that he's afraid to get hurt, and the promo that The Miz busts out after that, and the ripple effect of The Miz's career after that week, with Dolph Ziggler coming out and calling him a coward, and just starting this whole track of The Miz becoming the nonstop intercontinental champion, and building his ego and using Daniel Bryan's moves. Like I said, even if Daniel Bryan's not really in the picture for him at that moment, like that storyline is still boiling underneath everything. And every couple of weeks they kind of go back to it. And it fuels them even more. I think it has elevated The Miz, and has made me more interested in Daniel Bryan as a GM.
Yeah.
So that is my favorite storyline of this year.
And in some ways, like, I had honestly considered Daniel Bryan for Most Improved based solely on mic work, because that stuff with The Miz has gotten both of them, like, Miz was already good on the mic, but Daniel Bryan was not. And he definitely got better because of that, and he got better real quick. I mean, granted, I guess it's just being in a speaking role every week as the general manager certainly helped, but he's done, yeah. But that storyline, the two of them working together, is just so they're great together.
Yes.
How about you, Art?
Samoa Joe versus William Regal.
Yes.
Ooh. Yes. Okay. All right.
Because I've really enjoyed having like a wrestler feuding with a non-wrestler, which I guess is also what Miz and Daniel Bryan is. But until
different.
The Miz stands in the ring every Angrier. Week and shouts out, Brian! I'm not into it as much as that.
Regal!
Regal!
So good. And it shows that you don't have to do like the WWE trope of the authority figure is always the bad guy to make a good storyline. Like, yeah. You get multiple examples of that, the authority figure being a good guy and it being excellent storyline material. Like, it's okay to feel bad or sympathize with an authority figure. They don't all have to be assholes.
Absolutely.
I mean, maybe recent events in the world have proven me wrong, but at least in wrestling, it's not the case.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a really, 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 really good one, Art.
Absolutely. It's one I hadn't even thought of, but that's perfect. So let's see. We only got a couple left from what I'm seeing. So let's see. Do you want to do female superstar or male superstar next? Well, I guess female superstar or best superstar.
And the third one, we haven't done match.
We haven't done, right? I was going to save that one for last.
All right, great.
That's one I feel like we may all agree on also. So we'll see if I'm right. Let's go with best female wrestler of the year. Okay. And right. I gave that to Charlotte Flair. Because I think she's had, this has been a hell of a year for her. Like, for all the reasons we stated, she's gone from really, you know, coming in on name alone. I mean, I guess not even coming in on name alone, coming in as Charlotte with Ric Flair. But always that with Ric Flair at the end. You know, and he came in and it was like, just the, in a lot of ways, the changes with Charlotte to me are show the changes in the women's division, in that there was a period where when Charlotte was coming out with Rick every week and he was interfering in all the matches, and it was like, how, you know, is it a women's revolution if somehow every storyline still involves Ric Flair? Like, that's mm-hmm. And then it's from then, like I said, getting rid of Ric Flair was the best thing that she did this year, or that WWE did this year, and that it changed the whole tone of that division and all the matches in it, and they become, you know, like I said, you know, first women's cage match. Now there's one on SmackDown coming up too next week, mm-hmm. and it's just, it's changing women's wrestling in a way. That I guess WWE hasn't really done in a long, long time. And it's just, in a lot of ways, the trajectory of her career last year was also the trajectory of the women's division. And she's a great heel in it. And definitely a good if they're going to have someone hold the belt and be the shining beacon of the women's division, she's like an excellent choice as far right now. That's,
I agree, yeah, 100%.
Same. Yeah. Also, she won the women's championship 4 times this year, so, or in 2016, so that has to count for something.
She's got more titles than Roman. More runs with big belts than Roman. U.S. Title doesn't count.
we all agree that Charlotte kind of wins this thing, but I don't think she gets there without Sasha
at all. It was a hard choice between the two of them this year, 100%.
Yeah. Yeah, it's almost a tie in my book, mm-hmm. because like in NXT, they kind of just elevated each other.
Oh yeah,
and then when they got to the main roster, it kind of reset, and they're finally hitting their stride again. Mm-hmm.
And the only reason I gave it to Charlotte over Sasha is what Art said, is that face Sasha doesn't fit her as well, and Charlotte just like, she kills it on the heel roll, like, mm-hmm. really does. But, yeah, you're right, Sasha. Without Sasha, there is, like, no best female wrestler for Charlotte, you know?
Yeah, and I don't know what has to happen right now, not right now, of course, but in 2017, I would probably like to see Charlotte and Sasha split brands.
Yeah,
if possible. Sure.
Keep them away from each other.
Sasha on SmackDown or Charlotte on SmackDown, something.
Mm-hmm. I agree. I think
them to new stuff.
Yeah, some distance between them, I think, would not be a bad idea. Totally.
205 Live.
There you go.
Perfect.
Make a third belt.
Charlotte or Sasha could take any of the chumps in that division.
That's true.
Let's see. All right. Best. What's up?
Nothing. I was going to say, is Alicia Fox technically part of the 205 Live?
Alicia
roster?
Fox.
I can't do it. I'm not Irish.
Maybe next year we should have a best cruiserweight. Except right now, no one wins it. I guess Jack Gallagher.
It's Neville.
Yeah, he's the king of the cruiserweights.
Heel Neville has been a delight.
It's exactly what that character needed. All right. Best superstar. John Carson.
AJ Styles.
I also picked AJ Styles.
He's had a stellar year. He started off the year with a fantastic match against Shinsuke Nakamura. Mm-hmm. Not 30 days later, is in the WWE and in the Royal Rumble, the two. Number two or three entrant?
Three, yeah. Three.
That reaction, because he was right after Rusev, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, just like, what? Yeah, it was... It was the kind of thing where even though kind of like the smarks all knew was happening, that doesn't mean like it was still awesome.
I couldn't tell what was happening because WWE just wanted to show Reigns' reaction the whole time.
Yeah.
And then cut over to AJ Styles when it's like too late.
They've apparently fixed that. I don't know if it's on YouTube or the network or what, but they've fixed that.
It is now fixed. Okay. Yeah.
Good.
And then like I mean, in a lot of ways, like AJ showing up got WWE to recognize outside companies more. Like as he goes down the ramp, like JBL is yelling about titles in New Japan. Like what? You know, yeah. Like not a lot of other guys. And like immediately as he's coming down the ramp, JBL is talking about New Japan titles and instantly compares him to Brock Lesnar, who at that time was like, it's like the baddest dude, you know? Yeah.
And they had to describe who he was because for the common WWE fan, they might not have heard of him unless they watched an episode of Velocity like 15 years ago, whatever the show was that he was on. Mm-hmm. And so he had this great buzz coming in. I think he made an impact coming in. But around WrestleMania, his character got very stale. And then they turned him heel, and I think he did just a great job with that heel persona for the rest of the year.
Oh, yeah. He's done great. And then the whole, like, beating John... Like, once again, like, beating John Cena
beat
is,
beat up
like,
John Cena.
Beat up John Cena. Face the champ that runs the camp. Like...
I don't like that one.
I like that one a lot, because it's so dumb. It's just so dumb that it's so perfect.
It's real dumb. But, like, even pulling off the whole Dean Ambrose, James Ellsworth... feud, yeah. and making it just very entertaining, and still considering him like a dominant champion mm-hmm. after all those shenanigans, it's great.
And then even then, he cut a promo on another one that cut a promo on Daniel Bryan on Talking Smack, which was great. Like, you know, first calling out Daniel Bryan for not taking the World Heavyweight title seriously, and then. Calling him a bad authority figure for putting James Ellsworth into harm's way. Basically, like, you know I can beat the hell out of him. Why are you doing this to him? You are a bad person. Like, it was great. Let's get, like, cutting a promo on Daniel Bryan is, like, the way to win an award, it seems, this year.
Well, and I really loved, and this is, like, not super about AJ, but that, like, yeah, Ellsworth beat AJ three times or whatever, but no one, you never believed that he was a threat to AJ. Like, as soon as they had that, like, actual match.
Yeah, that was the perfect ending to that storyline.
I wanted to see where that went next, though, because it was just fun.
Yeah, but it did, it was, yeah, that ending to that storyline was perfect. Like, let's have a real match, let's see what happens. Oh, wait, it's over. Like,
yeah.
Perfect. Now you go to the hospital, just like I said was going to happen.
And he saved Ellsworth's life like 4 weeks before that.
When Flash. That's true. Gosh. Oof. Thank goodness. Okay. Art, is that, I assume, is AJ Styles also your choice? Or
absolutely, yeah.
Yeah. Perfect. So let's do the final award of the night. Mm-hmm. Best... WWE match of the year. So this is, like I said, I think this is one I'm betting we agree on, but we'll see if I'm right. My best match of the year is the Revival versus DIY 2 out of 3 falls match at TakeOver Toronto.
It's real good.
That match
was good one.
Not only was it just a great tag match, which you don't like, You just don't. You legitimately don't see that in WWE anymore. They have forgotten what good tag matches are. Like, I think it was Art said it, like, whenever the last time we had the tornado tag match, what's the difference between a tornado tag match and a regular tag match in current WWE? It's the same thing, because everyone's always in the ring all time anyway. But this match was an actual real tag match, and so many of the false finishes 100% played off of every WWE trope for how tag matches are supposed to end. And they just said, no, we're not actually ending it here. Like, let's keep going and keep going and keep going. And it was just a good old-fashioned wrestling match with still good, you know, flips, that kind of thing, but just solid actual tag match action.
Some say no flips.
Just fists.
Just fists.
Yeah. That's right. Now, maybe I'm wrong. It doesn't seem like we actually all agree on this, but that is, like, for me, that's my favorite
up there for
WWE
me.
Match.
Yeah, that's definitely a great match.
So what was your...
I went with Zayn Nakamura from TakeOver Dallas.
Mm-hmm. That's me too.
And I thought really hard about Styles Reigns from Extreme Rules. I thought that match is real underrated.
Also, for what it's worth, another contender I almost put up there was AJ Styles versus John Cena. Their last match was pretty good. But, yeah, Nakamura, Sami Zayn was...
Yes.
And that's a match that I watched in person, and then when I got back to the hotel, I put on the WWE Network and watched it two more times, and then the next day I watched it again. Like, it was amazing.
Just the inertia of that match is amazing. Like, it just starts off as a regular WWE match, and kind of introducing you to Shinsuke. And as the match goes on and on, you start seeing more of the strong style come out. Mm-hmm. And so Shinsuke starts using it. And then eventually, like, the only way that Sammy could possibly beat him is to just go stiff as hell. Where it's almost dudes, like, cringe.
Those two dudes beat the hell out of each other.
Yeah. And it was awesome.
Yeah.
Like, that is hands down. Like, it's Sammy's farewell match for NXT.
Introduction of Shinsuke.
Introduction of the new king of NXT. Yeah, it's everything about it's great. I'd say my other honorable mention would be Kevin Owens and Dean Ambrose from the Royal Rumble last year. The last man standing match?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Is that what it was?
Solid.
And then they both come out in the Rumble limping.
Oh,
and like
perfect. Like
it's
another thing you just don't see anymore match. Is like real like post match selling. You know, the last person I can think of that did that a lot was Daniel Bryan actually.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, just that Nakamura Sami Zayn match was like my like 1.5 of the year. You know, like it was right there. But
yeah. I also want to shout out Sami Zayn versus Kevin Owens from whatever pay-per-view that was.
Yeah. Battleground?
The first one they did? Yeah, that was...
Yeah, where he's like... Because there's two really great moments in there. There's the one where like Owens is like yelling at him to stay down, which is like a general heel tactic, but like because of the weight of that storyline, it feels, you know, Owens is telling him to stay down not just because he hates him, but because he doesn't hate him.
Yeah, exactly. It's, yeah, because I don't hate you, I don't want to hurt you. Yeah.
And then Zayn ends the match with that second unnecessary haluva kick that, like...
Where he just, like, picks him up in the corner and just, like, I have to do this. This is the only way this ends.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, he's grabbing, like, the lifeless Kevin Owens and putting him back up to kick him again is, like... an important capstone to that.
Yeah.
Sami Zayn's real good, I think, is what I'm...
Yes. Yeah, totally.
He deserves better than this Braun Strowman
nonsense.
Shit.
Yeah. Yeah, I have to agree.
He's making the best of it.
Braun Strowman's another guy I feel like has good potential for next year's Most Improved Award, though.
Braun Strowman, the man who can most take a chair... repeatedly 2 weeks in a row.
It's a solid skill to have, honestly. Well, that's 2016 someone in wrestling.
Tinder bio. Someone on the internet found like his.
Yeah.
And Tinder bio. He looks weird. He looks weird in the ring. He looks weird in clothes. He's a weird looking guy.
He's just a big dude. It's hard to look normal as a big guy.
Yeah.
I mean, he is a mountain.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Genetically, yeah. A mountain.
That's one of Vince's nicknames, right? The genetic mountain.
Fish.
That sounds like it.
Oh. 2016 was a pretty good year, guys.
It was a good year for wrestling. Yeah. Absolutely.
We got the brand split again.
And I think it's helped.
I was very worried about it, but it made SmackDown a must-see show.
Yeah, absolutely.
More so than Raw.
It turned SmackDown from a show that I legitimately had no interest in ever seeing, no matter who was on it,
mm-hmm.
to a show that I have to watch every week. And it's unexpected. Definitely. Also, you know, cruiserweights.
Cruiserweights are back.
Cruiserweight Classic, like
that was a great tournament.
There was some matches in the Cruiserweight Classic, like that last championship match was. I mean, was a hell of a match.
Tommaso Ciampa and Johnny Gargano in the first round.
Yeah,
like that was a showstopper.
Yeah,
or second round It was early.
Yeah, there was some good stuff, and I think this year with the UK thing, and then, I don't know, I had heard that there's plans for a Japan thing, too? But I don't know if that's actually...
I heard they want to do a women's tournament.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, that I heard about. That should be cool. It should be... 2017, I feel like, could definitely shape up to be a good year in wrestling. Mm-hmm. But there's something more important than wrestling, guys.
The Diablo 1 remake and Diablo 3?
I mean, that's pretty important. But I think more important than just wrestling is the world around wrestling. Mm. Art, please tell us about Total Divas.
Okay. So they've been doing like the big thing is mm-hmm. We're starting to get to the Paige stuff.
Mm-hmm.
She gets hurt and she gets just crazy mad at Eva Marie because she thinks Eva Marie told the office that she was hurt, but like she's seriously hurt and she shouldn't be wrestling, and everyone knows it. There's no like, it's not, this isn't Eva Marie sabotaging Paige or anything. But it's like kind of a look into Paige going a little nuts, especially because like she's got her Alberto tattoo now.
Did they show her getting that?
They didn't show her getting it. They showed her, like, showing it to, again, Eva Marie. And Eva Marie being like,
"That's
you know, weird. Why? That's a really big tattoo on your boob."
Oh, it's a boob. Like,
right, I didn't realize that.
I saw the one on her finger.
Yeah, I knew she had
She has Poppy on her
finger. Yeah.
She has Alberto, like, here.
Oh, I didn't know
like,
about that.
Like, covered by your ring gear, but, like, ooh. But, like, whoa.
Wow. Yeah. Wild.
Hey, what's your favorite storyline on Total Divas this year? Or Total Bellas? The Total Universe.
That's true. Who wins what's the Suplexy Award for best Total reality storyline?
I mean, it's the whole Total Bellas thing, the whole, like, Nikki injury.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Plus the Daniel Bryan stuff, which, like, with the capstone of trying to teach Nikki new finishing moves when Daniel Bryan had retired. Perfect. but that's sort of only because not eligible for it was Natty's sister. This is like two episodes ago, wanted to start doing a cooking class. That Natty and her sister were going to start doing a cooking class, and Natty wanted to get people for it, and she doesn't know anyone. So what she did was she went and paid a bunch of wrestlers and like their like immediate friends to show up to this cooking class.
God.
So it's like Big E is there, Titus is there, I've more people, it's been a little bit, but this pays off with one of the friends like slips that they were paid to be at the class. Instead of paying to attend the class, Natty paid them, And there's this great delivery. Like, she's like, so are we going to get paid for this every week? And Big E just immediately goes, I don't think we're supposed to say that. And the
oh no.
And it's all like, you should be helping me. I want to help you, you know, all of this.
Oh no.
And it ends with like, she's really sad, but then she turns around for her when she finds out that Big E sent a text to Natty saying how good her sister looked. Because like two seasons ago or whatever, Big E went on a date with Natty's sister. And that's an all time Total Divas classic.
Oh, I need
Big E and Natty's sister.
Yeah.
Every time we talk about Total Divas, you sell it so well for me. And I just never pull the trigger on it.
Because it's I feel like this is the best way to experience it, is through the excitement of someone else.
I mean, I think if you ever find yourself with like 45 minutes to kill, get on the network and find the episode where Big E dates Natty, goes on a date with Natty's sister. I don't think that'll disappoint you at all.
Okay.
So I did get a message from Phil that he does regret not being here, but I think what we'll do is I'll just put his awards in the show notes. Sure. That way people can at least see, you know, because I don't, you know.
Can we just get sound bites from him and just you edit it in?
Sure.
To our discussion.
I'll just tell him to record a sound bite saying I agree and I definitely don't agree, and I'll just put those in randomly.
Can we like make some sound bites right now?
The best storyline of Total Divas, and he'll just go, no, 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 no. We can just make like spots for Phil.
Yeah, and I'll just say something like, Phil, that is fucked up.
Well, there we go. That's the sound bite. That's perfect. I'm just going to cut that out.
Can't believe you just said that, Phil.
Phil, that's frankly offensive.
Phil, that's put your pants on, for crying out loud. No one wants to see that.
Filthiest thing you've ever said to me, Phil. You've said some filthy things.
All right.
And now Sammy's Wrestler of the Year.
That's 100% true. Yeah, John Cena is the answer, by the way. I already know that. I already know that. Everyone knows.
How can he like what he can't see?
Whoa. That's deep. All right.
Wait, do you have Phil's list? What's Phil's worst award? Where is he the most wrong?
I can probably guess that. He's going to find a way to give the most improved award to Dolph Ziggler, and I'm going to 100% disagree with him. That's what's going to happen. Like, I can already sense it in my bones. Whatever. All right, so we'll be back for the Royal Rumble. Gosh, that's the 29th. So
that's 3 weeks, right?
Yeah. So we'll be back in 2 weeks. The 25th. Yeah,
the 25th.
Yeah.
If anyone in Minnesota is listening to this weekend, I will see you at WrestlePalooza on Sunday.
Ooh, what's WrestlePalooza? It'll be good.
It's they have it a couple times a year here, but it's at a music venue. First Ave, they have just a big wrestling show. Arya Daivari is our champion.
Ooh.
He is going to be fighting someone. Colt Cabana is going to be there.
He's from there, right? From Minneapolis?
He's from like the next town over.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah, a lot of cool wrestlers going to be here.
Cool.
Did you say St. Paul?
Is that close?
No, he's from a town called Brooklyn Park, I believe. Or at least that's where his wrestling school is.
Hmm.
Man, everyone's from either Champlin or Brooklyn Park if they're a wrestler from Minnesota. Besides Brock. He's from, like, Alexandria.
All right. Well, I'm tired, but I'm going to stay up and watch people speedrun games, I think.
Yeah, I'm going to have a couple drinks and wake up late for work tomorrow.
There we go. Well, before you do so, John.
Responsibility. Yes.
Where can people find you on the internet, bud?
You can find me on the internet on Twitter at John_Carson. Maybe one day when I find my Elgato, you can find me and Dylan streaming near.
I'm going to send you my Elgato.
Hopefully. I don't know where it went to. Yeah, that's about it for the internet.
Any good reviews going up?
XBLAfans.com, I guess.
You guys just had your Game of the Year stuff, right?
We did. Our Game of the Year, I believe, was Inside.
Wow, spoilers.
Yeah, or really, just go read what my little couple paragraphs was on, and that's the best game that everyone forgot in 2016.
We'll keep that one a secret.
It's technically not a 2016 game, because you know how games release these days.
Oh, yeah. That's true.
It's Rebel Galaxy. Play Rebel Galaxy.
Yes. That's a good call.
Yeah.
Art, where can folks find you on the internet? You got a lot of stuff going on now.
Yeah, they can check out Friends at the Table at friendsatthetable.net or on their podcast, whatever. They can read movie reviews I write at comicmix.com, and they can follow me on Twitter if they want to hear tweets, including me complaining about how close Elimination Chamber is to the Royal Rumble, which is only 2 weeks.
What?
That's E-table. Yeah. 2 weeks from Rumble to Elimination Chamber, and then like 5 weeks to Fastlane, and then like another 4 weeks to WrestleMania.
Gosh, really should have spread that out.
Is it Elimination Chamber a SmackDown pay-per-view?
Yeah, maybe. Elimination Chamber, SmackDown, Fastlane is Raw.
I feel like that's close. Isn't Elimination Chamber in like Phoenix this year? I think
it is.
Yes, it is.
The also, Zord Arena.
You would think that
I could drive there.
We've talked about this.
Yeah, I know
we have.
Offline. Yeah.
They really should have swapped Fastlane. Like Fastlane should be right after the Royal Rumble if it's a Fastlane.
Sure, yeah.
You get there real quick.
Zoom, zoom.
Nothing should be 2 weeks after the Royal Rumble. I just think the big four should breathe a little more.
Yeah. Are they doing a takeover for that?
Yeah.
For the Rumble? Yeah. Not for Elimination Chamber, no.
Wait, where is the Rumble? Oh, it's in San Antonio. That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's why it's Remember the Rumble. I only got that one.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yes, I beat you to that one, so
I feel like they're just bashing that over people's heads right now.
Okay, that didn't click with me for some reason.
It's not the best.
Well, people can find me on the internet at on Twitter at Dylan Hecht, DylanHecht. Mm-hmm. I'll be tweeting about the Switch maybe tomorrow. Super excited. Looking forward to that.
Yeah,
as someone who only owns an Xbox One, I would like a console that's useful, please.
Handheld.
What up? I'm looking forward to it. Also, if you want to buy my 3DS, it's on Craigslist right now. It's limited edition. It still has the box with it, so.
Is it the Year of Luigi one?
It is the Majora's Mask new 3DS.
Okay, that's pretty good.
That's right. So if you live in Albuquerque, hit me up.
I don't.
So I can buy a Switch with that money. A thing like sells for, if the Switch is $300, I could almost buy a Switch with what this thing supposedly sells for. Who knew?
It's pretty good.
All right. You can find Phil Kohler, who isn't here, but his awards will be in the show notes at polygon.com. They just put up a cool article about Final Fantasy VII. That's really good. And P. Kohler on Twitter. But he's not here, so fuck his promos. I'm just going to cut those out.
We should be back in 2 weeks on the 25th for the Royal Rumble.
We'll be back for the Royal Rumble, my favorite pay-per-view of the year.
Pretty good.
Super excited. But until then, watch Wrestle Kingdom 11, for crying out loud.
That's your homework. We're bringing homework back.
Yeah, because this is something we've all watched already, so this is the perfect way to do homework.
I have not watched it.
Well, fucking get to it already.
I know, that's why it's homework. Okay. I have to do it.
All right.
At the last minute.
I'll watch it again. And until then, wait, 3DS is... Jones Comma Ice Cream just revealed you can stream off the 3DS now? Oh, wow. All right, maybe I won't sell this thing. We'll see. All right, plans are changing at the last minute. But we'll get an update on this right before the Royal Rumble episode. But until then, we'll see you later, Internet. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.